व्यायाम और मेरा व्यायाम और है.
So what I am going to say is something you will never have heard before, and probably you won't hear often again. It is a very shocking news that I will provide for you. So I guess this title explains what I want to say. Econometrics is maybe another name for fraud by numbers. So the Joan Robinson quote, "The purpose of studying economics is not to acquire a set of ready-made answers to economic questions, but to learn how to avoid being deceived by economists." This applies also with very great force to econometrics. So we learn econometrics not to understand the real world, but to avoid being to prevent the attacks of the economic hitmen. If you are familiar with the Perkins book, Confessions of an Economic Hitman, so basically used econometric techniques to deceive countries into thinking that this loan that they were going to take would be profitable for them, when in fact it was a method of their enslavement. And today econometrics are used in exactly the same way. So let me show you. So here's a regression I ran just for the, I just picked up three series at random. One was the private consumption expenditure in Pakistan. Then there is SUR, which is, this is all from WDI data set, World Development Index, which is very large, huge, respectable data set. So SUR is survival to age 65 of females as a percentage of their cohort. And CO2 is the carbon dioxide emissions from gaseous fuel consumption. So here is the regression. Its consumption is minus 268.7 plus 6.78 SUR minus 1.8272 plus epsilon. R squared is 84%. It has a F statistic of 22, which is highly significant. The numbers in the parentheses are the standard errors, and from those you would be able to see that all of these coefficients are highly significant. So now we have a new theory of consumption in Pakistan. See, consumption depends on the survival to age 65. I guess these females eat a lot after 65, so they contribute enormously to Pakistani consumption. Also, carbon dioxide emissions has a very negative impact. So this regression is like all other regressions. This is what I want to say. This, just like this regression is complete nonsense, so 99% of the regressions that are published are complete nonsense. They have no meaning. So now, this is shocking because, you know, when, if you say that there is a, if there is a 25-year-old person and he's making a mistake which only 5-year-olds make, 2 plus 2 equals 5, for example, he says, then there is something to explain. It's not, you know, that there is a very deep and difficult and sophisticated mistake which somebody has made in the course of very complex calculations. That one can understand. But for somebody to make such huge mistakes, any basic mistakes, this is very difficult to understand. That also requires explanation. And so I'm going to provide an explanation of why econometrics is in such sad state, and economics also is in such terrible state. It is pathetic. It is built on fallacies which a 7-year-old could see through, and yet we are all teaching it and reading it and studying it and trying to understand it. And we have difficulty understanding it because it's inherently not understandable, because it's nonsense. It's hard to understand nonsense because nonsense is nonsense. So, I'm not going to go deeply into the philosophy, but the major problem arose with Immanuel Kant. He made a huge blunder, and that blunder is the foundation of modern Western social science. So, what he said was that there is something which is called the noumena, which is the hidden reality, which is generates the phenomena, which is what we see. This is very easy to understand. You're looking at that clock, and it has a couple of hands, and they are moving. But inside that clock, there is a mechanism which drives this hand. So what you can see is very different from the hidden reality. Now, the hidden reality is very complex. What you see is very simple. You see the hands moving in a very straight line, but how this was done, that's a massively complex operation. So what he said was that these two are sharply separated, of course, and unfortunately, what he said was that we only have access to the phenomena. That's true. I can't see what's hidden. So what he said that was that people are wasting time thinking about what is hidden. He called it the thing in itself. And he said thing in itself exists, but there's no way for us to access this. So just forget about it. I mean, we only deal with the phenomena. So we should think, you see, there are three elements. There is our mind, which looks at the phenomena, and then there is the hidden reality, which generates the phenomena. So the traditional way of thinking and the correct way of thinking is that, does the picture that we have in our mind correspond to the hidden reality? And he explicitly said, this is how the pre-Kantian philosophers thought about it. I can make some guess about what that mechanism must be. That is my hypothesis. And then my hypothesis is true or not according to whether or not the picture that I have matches the true underlying mechanism. He said all philosophers up till now have considered the problem like this, and they have all been wrong. And I am going to introduce a Copernican revolution in philosophy. And he said, you see, this problem cannot be solved. This problem cannot be solved because we will never know what the hidden reality is. So this question can never be answered. So instead, what we are going to see, instead what I propose that we should do from now on, is to look at how our mind analyzes observable, so cut out the hidden reality. So instead of any, the pre-Kantian philosophers used to think about whether the models in our mind match the hidden reality, he says, no, let's look at how the mind models match the observations. Forget about reality. So that was the Kantian revolution, and that was very influential. And today, econometrics, economics, psychology, and nearly all social sciences are working on completely wrong foundations, which is why they are leading to completely nonsensical results. So I'll explain that more clearly. So one of the problems that we have today as a experienced teacher, my first goal in teaching is that I find that our students lack self-confidence because they have swallowed a Eurocentric version of history, according to which the Europeans claim that the whole world was in darkness. And then in 16th century Europe, the sun of reason first arose in Europe, and Then they learned to think, the Europeans, and they learned this thing called science. And the science was used to overcome their superstitions, which were religion. And then they made tremendous progress in all fields, in all dimensions. They learned how to, and humanity, and democracy, and governance. And so today, every good thing known to mankind was discovered in Europe between 16th and 18th century. And so our students become very depressed that, you know, we have been, we have 14 years of history as Muslims, and we have never done anything significant. So how can we possibly contribute anything to mankind? So starting from this depressed position, our students fail to accomplish anything significant. Now there is a very interesting study studies show that, you know, in rural schools in Pakistan, and this has been replicated all over the world, why are the learning outcomes so poor? This is the question. Now, a lot of people have answered, okay, infrastructure is bad, teacher qualification is low, teachers don't know how to teach, Allah, Allah, lots of speculations exist. But if you look at the data, there's a LEAP survey, they look at these things one by one and they reject all of them. Our government public school teachers are highly qualified, much better than the private school teachers, which outshine them. Our public school teachers are well paid relative to the private school. Infrastructure is not too good, but that's not the obstacle to education everywhere. And we all know stories about how people sat on mats and students and accomplished great things. So that's not the issue. Do the public school teachers not know how to teach? That was a crucial hypothesis. That also was rejected because you found that if you gave them classes and if they were teaching private tuition, they do very well. They are good teachers. So then it's a real mystery as to why you're not getting good outcomes. And ultimately, the answer turns out to be the software. It is not the hardware. The software is that the teacher does not expect anything of these rural children, because they never amount to anything. And the crucial experiment which proved this was that they did a dummy experiment. This has been replicated. That they did a dummy test. They took tests of all of the students and they said, oh, these two students in your class, they are super geniuses. They have the IQ of Einstein, just at random. At the end of the semester, these students had great scores. Why? Because the teacher said that, oh, these two students are going far, and he invested time, he expected a lot of them, and they also expected to perform. So this idea that we are backwards and we are behind, I was once teaching a class in the first class in Introduction to Statistics, and I explained, I was starting with the really trivial stuff, like, okay, here is a list of numbers, we sort this list, and we will pick the middle number, and that's the median. Then I asked one of the students that, okay, now do these three steps for me on this median. So he was blank. So I said, look, do you understand what I was doing? He said, sir, aapne jo text described, yeah, this is from an advanced country. These people have a lot of background. I come from a poor backwards area, and I can't really compete with them. So basically, he was sitting at the lecture, and he had already turned off his mind switch because he knew that he would not understand what I was going to teach in advance. He didn't bother to make the effort. So I asked him that, look, if you have two numbers, can you tell which one is bigger and which one is smaller? So he said, yes, I know how to do that. So then I know that's all you need to know how to sort the list. And if you have a list of seven numbers, can you count which one is the fourth one? So he know how to do that, but the point was that the technical skills were there that were necessary, but he had already given up hope of the possibility of understanding. So the first goal that I have with my students is to give them confidence that we have achieved in the past. And actually a lot of what we are being taught is designed to impress, and it is not designed to be true. That's the rhetoric of economics. It's designed to make fool people into thinking that we know a lot of things when in fact they don't know anything. It's like exactly the confessions of the economic hitman. So you do a very complicated model using advanced econometric techniques, and the other person doesn't understand. So he goes, okay, whatever you say, it must be true. So now, one thing that is important in this context is to understand how is it that the son of, we all know that the Middle Ages, the Dark Ages of Europe, they were very ignorant. They were really barbarians, savages. They were fighting each other continuously. And we didn't have it. And right next to them, there was this Islamic Spain, Andalus, which was a very advanced civilization, very sophisticated, high technology, luxuries. So how did suddenly the son of reason, light, the Enlightenment occur in Europe there? So it was basically because the Islam Andalus, which had gone on for 700 years, which is twice the age of the modern European civilization, it decayed, and it became the people there became very luxury loving, and they became decadent, like all civilizations do, as written in the Quran. So they were conquered by the so-called reconquest by vigorous and barbaric Europeans, and the Europeans got access to millions of books in the libraries of Islamic Spain, which were contained knowledge from all over the world, because Islamic civilization was very eclectic. They took the Greeks, they took the Chinese, they took Indians, they took knowledge from wherever they could find. And it was all there. So this knowledge, 200 years it took in Europe to assimilate this knowledge, and this is called the famous battle between science and religion, which took place. The science was actually those books of Andalus, which they were struggling to absorb, and they were having great difficulty. The church imposed censorship on these, and every book that was published had to get the imprimatur of the church. Nihil obstat, the no objection certificate had to be given in order that the book should be allowed to be published. And and all of these thoughts were very much in conflict with Catholic teachings, and so there were huge problems. And so whenever somebody would publish a book like, you know, Copernicus with the heliocentric theory, he would get, this was the Inquisition. They would get tortured, and so Copernicus's friend, I forgot his name, was actually imprisoned and tortured for 10 years for heresy, and many churchmen. All of these books were actually taken by the church itself, because there was no other institutions of learning in Europe. So many people were tortured, some were burned, for translating heretical thought. So Copernicus actually translated a book by Ibn Shakir. But he could not acknowledge this, because he had seen what happens to those who... So he has a very obsequious praise of the Pope in the beginning. And he published the book after on his deathbed, so that to escape consequences. So now he is known as the revolutionary. And in fact, this idea of heliocentric, this is available in Ghazali and the mathematics, the elliptics, the calculus, the quadratics, they're all in Islamic literature, but we don't know. We think that mathematics was invented by Europe and so on. So this is very important to understand that the this is just for to understand that it is not true. But basically in the this was a general process that nearly everything there's even a paper that I saw that nearly everything that is attributed as an invention of Europe has been actually invented by Muslims. But they were forced to do this because the church did not allow. And it took them about 2 centuries to assimilate this knowledge. And in the end, this caused the destruction of Christianity, and the Catholic Church was shattered, and Protestants emerged, and then they had tremendous and violent battles with each other. And this resulted in loss of faith. When you see all the religious people fighting each other, then you say, well, this religion does nothing except cause trouble. And so this is a general hidden message in the European teaching, which causes damage to us because we think that this is a general thing. This is not, this is, they are talking about their historical experience, but they say it in such a way that we think that religion is the source of problem and trouble. This hidden message is available throughout social science books, textbooks that we read. It's not openly there on the surface. So anyway, the important thing to understand here is that the science was developed, invented by, scientific method was invented by Ibn al-Haysam. It was taken into Europe, but it was never understood until today. And even now, in science they have correctly, because science is a practice, so physics, etc., they know how to do that, and you know, they have made a lot of developments and progress in that. But scientific method, the philosophy of science, that was never understood. Bacon misunderstood it as induction, later Descartes misunderstood it as deduction, and it is neither of those. Actually, we will discuss this a little bit later, but there's this book called What is This Thing Called Science by Chalmers, which is currently used as a textbook, and it discusses 18 different interpretations of what is science and comes to the conclusion that we don't know. So basically, although they got science from the Muslims, they never really understood. But even more important to them than that, science was one of the least important things in the Islamic heritage. The most important thing in the Islamic heritage was how we can learn to be human beings. That was the main and central message of Islam. That لَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ فِي أَحْسَنِ تَقْوِيمٍ ثُمَّ رَدَدْنَاهُ أَسْفَلَ سَافِلِينَ. That we have created man in the, with the potential to be higher than the angels, and also with the potential to be lower than the beast. So now the question is, how can you learn to be a human being which is superior to the angels? This is the what the message of Islam teaches, and there is nothing like that in all of your physics and chemistry and biology. You will not find one word which will tell you how you can learn to be a human being. And unfortunately, Muslims are so impressed with Western science that they think that today the road to our deliverance, the road to our future development will come from studying chemistry and physics, and not from learning how to be better human beings. And that is the central message of Islam. So now I want to come back to the topic of this particular seminar, which is about data analysis. So what I want to say is that this mistake, this mistaken understanding of science, is at the heart of the problem that we have in social sciences today, which is why today econometrics is complete garbage, and also economics that we are teaching, Samuelson, etc., this is also complete garbage, because it is based on this Kantian blunder that all we have is appearances. We cannot ask about hidden realities. And actually, the only thing which matters is approaching the hidden reality. So what is science? The definition is very simple, even though the whole book doesn't approach it. Basically, science comes from looking at the universe and deducing the existence of the creator. That's the method, the scientific method. Look at the phenomena and understand the noumena, the underlying hidden reality which produces this phenomena. So, looking at the creation of God and understanding that there exists the creator of God. That, however, is not part of their philosophy of science. So what is their philosophy of science? It is a nominalist philosophy, and this is the philosophy which is nominalist. Basically, there are two opposing things. Nominalist is names, which is appearances, and realist is what is in the background. So a nominalist philosophy deals only with the names, with the appearances. So according to this philosophy, every pattern that we see in the data is a law, or potentially a law. It could be a law, it could not be. So when we see a pattern in the data, we say, okay, here is a hypothesis. Maybe this is my law. A regression is nothing more than a pattern that you see in the data. And you see a pattern and you say, okay, I will forecast, I will assume this pattern is a law, and I will forecast according to the assumption that this pattern will continue in the future. This is what regression is. But it is completely wrong. I mean, if there is a pattern, why should that pattern continue to exist and continue to operate in the future? It will only be true if that pattern is caused by some real force. There are some patterns which are accidental and some patterns which are caused by some real underlying force. So most patterns that we see, especially if we search hard, especially if we use the modern conventional econometric techniques, they will be accidental patterns. That is, they will be artifacts. And so when you forecast on these basis, you will make mistakes. So, as I've written here, it's not possible to find the determinants of FDI by running regressions, because regressions only look at patterns. Determinants is a causal relationship. So you can't find causal relationships by looking at patterns. All right, so very briefly, nominalist philosophy of science, which is underlying the econometrics and the economics that we do, is based on these three principles, that what we need to do in a data set is to search for a pattern, that is running regressions, and a law is a regression model. So a regression model which is high R squared is exactly the goodness of fit, which tells you whether or not there's a pattern. If R squared is low, then there's no pattern in the data. If R squared is high, it means that there is a pattern. So if you have a pattern, then that is your law. So the scientific method is to look for these laws. There are many different ways. So we have huge numbers of models that we can use to try to find patterns. And explanation and prediction proceeds by appeal to these laws. So if I want to forecast the future, I run a good regression and then I use that to forecast. Now these are all three wrong principles, but these are the basis of it. So as opposed to this, we have a realist philosophy. The realist philosophy says that we are looking for causal effects. Causal effects are all hidden. This is, why did this happen? That's trying to go beyond the phenomena, beyond what we see. I see a correlation between consumption and income. I say, why is this? So this is because human beings, when they get income, they consume from. Now this is not there in the numbers, this is not in the surface phenomena. It is the underlying hidden reality. And without having that, you can't understand what is going on. So that's what scientific law is. Scientific law goes to the hidden reality. It doesn't stop at the surface, doesn't stop at the R squared. So for example, if you run consumption of Pakistan on income of Pakistan, you will get a high R squared. Now it's very interesting, you can try it. If I take the consumption of Pakistan and run it on the income of India or of Brazil, I will get a very equally good regression. This is because both of these are highly time-trending series. So this is the well-known problem of spurious regression, which is misunderstood by econometrician. So now if I look at R squared and T stats and everything like that, I will say that, okay, consumption of Pakistan is determined by the GNP of Brazil. So how to differentiate? You have to go to the reality. What happens if you look at the underlying reality, then you can reject the second one as nonsense, and you can say that the first one is sensible. But if you just look at the appearances, there is no difference. So, scientific methodology consists of using abductive inference. So, what is abduction? Abduction is neither induction nor deduction. Abduction is to say that, this is just a name invented by one of the philosophers whose theories have been ignored more or less because they don't coincide. So, Francis Bacon got it wrong, Descartes got it wrong. Science is not about induction, science is not about deduction. Basically, it's about abduction means to look at the appearance and to deduce the underlying real explanation. For example, the apple fell on Newton's head, the proverbial apple. So he deduced that there is a hidden force called gravity which is causing this to happen. This is abduction. So explanation is causal, meaning that if I want to explain, I can't say that, okay, this regression fits so that this will happen. I can say that if I have a causal theory, increasing the money supply causes inflation, then I can use this theory to predict. So, if I have some theory which refers to the underlying causes, those causes, if that theory is correct, that will persist. So you see, if I look at a pattern and I say that, okay, this pattern will persist, that is meaningless because patterns may or may not persist. But if I have a real force which is hidden and underlying and is creating that pattern, then, so you see, in the past we have experience which shows that increasing, pumping money into the economy causes inflation. So I say, okay, now money has been pumped into the economy, so probably there will be inflation. So now I have an explanation, which is not just a regression. All right, so just to illustrate what I am saying, I'm going to do some analysis using infant mortality. This is again on the data set for Pakistan. I collected the figures on infant mortality, and I collected figures on GNP per capita, and then I ran a regression. Of course, infant mortality has been going down, GNP has been going up. So the regression says that infant mortality is equal to 183 minus 0.22 GNP. R squared is 0.95. Both coefficients are significant. So from this, you would conclude that GNP per capita is an important determinant of infant mortality. This is completely wrong. This is just a pattern in the data. What is the right conclusion? The right conclusion is the data shows there is a pattern. GNP in Pakistan has been going up. Infant mortality has been going down. But that doesn't mean that there is a causal relationship between the two. These two processes are separately occurring. So is there a connection? Is it a determinant? This is a hypothesis. This is a question. And how can we find out? We must trace the causal chain. How does increasing GNP affect infant mortality? So what we need to do is to look at, well, as GNP increases, governments make more money. Maybe they spend more on health. Maybe they spend on hospitals. Maybe the number of lady health workers is increasing. So you have to trace the causal chain. How did it happen? The underlying hidden mechanisms. And those things are what you will get. This is how you should run regressions if you need to run regressions. Although, as I say, regressions are not really necessary, but sometimes they are convenient. You can use them if you understand what they are. So, how to do regressions How not to do regression is just take any jumble bag assortment of variables and put some on one side and some on the other and conclude that you have a relationship. That's nonsense. You have to think about the real world. So what you need to do is to look at short causal chains, something which immediately causes the other thing. So for example, if we are talking about the link between money and prices, then it's not enough to say, okay, we have the quantity equation. That's ridiculous. What you need to do is to say, how is money actually created? You have to go beneath the surface. So we see that money is created in two ways. One is that the state bank prints some money, actually electronically. So then what happens to this money? Well, either it will loan it to the government or it will loan it to the private banks. Then the private banks also create money by expanding credit. So then who do they give this money to? Who borrows? And similarly, how does the government use the money that it has borrowed from the state bank? So this goes into salaries of people. So now what do the people do with their salary? Well, they buy things. So and then of course the other part of money. So all of these things have to be done step by step. And if you follow those steps, okay, and at each step you can run a regression. That if you go from X to its immediate implication Y, then that regression will reveal you something important. But if you go from money to prices directly, you will get nothing because there's too many intervening variables which are. So structural equation models is designed to help you trace the causal chains. Although since people do not understand this principle which I have explained to you, even in structural equation model, if you draw the wrong causal chains, you will get nonsense out of it. And that often happens. So, but structural equation models are potentially valuable tool if you can get the right causal chains. These are determined using path diagrams, etc. So basically, regressions, etc., these are just nonsense because econometrics is nonsense because basically you take the data and then you impose assumptions upon it in order to do data analysis. And all of these assumptions are wrong. All of you, if you have studied econometrics, you've studied the assumptions of the regression model that's listed very clearly in chapter 1, and then you never hear about it again. Why? Because all of these assumptions are false. They never hold. So all of your analysis is based on assumptions which are wrong, and you never mention it because actually if when you go to test those assumptions, you find that these assumptions never hold in the data. So basically, all of your regression model theory is based on fraud because your errors are not independent, they are not normal, they are not even stochastic usually, they don't follow the same distribution, your functional regression is not linear, you don't have exogeneity, so none of the assumptions hold in any real world data analysis. So basically it's just a way to fool people. I assume X, Y, and Z, and now I prove Z. There's a famous joke about the economist who had a can of food and he didn't have any can opener, so he said, okay, I will assume that this can is open and just eat it. So this is how it works. So basically then what data is helpful, but what you need to do is to just draw pictures of the data. So the thing is the data visualization in which we have developed a course recently in PIDE, this is the thing to do. Look at the data. Looking at the data gives you information, and there's nothing else, there's nothing more than the picture of the data. This is very important to understand. Many people think, and I also, when I was trained in economics, used to think that, okay, here is a data set, but if I apply a very sophisticated econometric technique, I will get some more information. No, the data that you see, that's all there is. That is the information. What your eye sees is the full set of information contained in that data. Now, if you want to make that data speak some more, then you have to torture it by applying econometric techniques. And you can make it speak because we know how to torture data to make it speak and make it say whatever we want, actually. This is the thing that's great about torture. And once you torture the data enough, it will say whatever you want it to say. So I have a course which is called Introduction to Statistics and Islamic Approach. This is available online. It has lectures, quizzes, video recorded lectures of mine. I have also students who have taken this course and they can act, and I would very much like for to popularize it. Recently at HEC, it was approved for use throughout Pakistan. So this incorporates a lot of the ideas that I'm discussing here. So one of the problems with the existing courses is that they are based on these courses. These theories were developed in the pre-computer era. In the pre-computer era, it was not possible to do complex calculations. So what they did was they substituted assumptions. Like, let's assume the data is normal. If you assume that the data is normal, then you can reduce it to two numbers, mean and standard deviation, and that captures all the information in the data. That makes it life easy. But, but the assumption is wrong. So basically you get wrong analysis. So basically if you study now in the computer, you find that the right numbers to use to analyze data, the measure of central tendency, is the median and not the mean. The mean is a very bad measure. The thing is that mean is the best measure for normal distribution and it is the worst measure for abnormal distributions. So when you assume that the data is normal, then you say, okay, I should take the mean and I should take the standard deviation, and these are what are taught. But if you say that I'll assume data is not normal, then you should never use the mean. So my course is based on a post-computer era idea where you can have the data, you can look at it, you can see that most often, most data sets are not normal. So here I will do some data analysis to show what I'm trying to say. So this is data on infant mortality. This is the WDI data set. So I have Afghanistan in 1960, the infant mortality is 252. I think it's per deaths per 100,000. Yes, I think it's that's it. In the first year. Then in 1961 it was 247 and so on. So this is a huge data set. And by looking at the numbers, we can't really see much. And if you do standard types of analysis, mean, standard deviation, you won't learn very much. What you can learn from is to by making pictures of the data. And that's what I'm going to show, what we can learn by making pictures. And that's data visualization. On data visualization, we have also developed a course at BID. And that's the way to go. I mean, instead of econometrics, we need to be teaching data visualization. So what can we learn? Well, basically, the key is exploratory data analysis. What we learn is confirmatory data analysis. Confirmatory data analysis occurs when you know exactly what is the model which is generating. So I'm just going to go through this one. So basically, you know in advance the model, and then you can run everything. So basically, regression analysis is based on something which is called the axiom of correct specification. If all of your assumptions are correct, then your regression results are correct. So this almost never happens. So it means that most regressions are nonsense and the discussion is meaningless because your assumptions are not verified. Now instead, here is my suggested alternative to regressions. So here I have just plotted the median infant mortality rate. Starts out at nearly 110. So what does this teach in 1960? So what does this tell us? Well, If we look at all the countries in the world development in the data set, I think there are about 160. There are more countries, but 160 for which data is available. So half of them had infant mortality below 110, and half of them had infant mortality above 110. And then the blue line, which is the median, has been going down quite sharply. So we can say that globally, all across the globe, infant mortality has declined quite sharply. It's gone from 120 to about 20, which is a five-fold reduction. It's dramatic, from 60 to 2010. So now we have learned this, and we have run a single regression. We just plotted the median birth rate over the, and the red line is the IQR, the interquartile range. So that has also been going down. It means that the dispersion in the rates of infant mortality, so we have been growing together. That is, the whatever medical advances are responsible for this, they have been spreading throughout the world. So you see, that's what I want to say, that this curve, as a numerical curve, it can be anything, but to understand it, you have to look at the what it is we are looking. This is the curve for infant mortality. It has a different meaning. If this was the curve for CO2 emissions, it would have a different meaning. And to understand this curve, we have to go to the hidden reality, to go to the famous noumena, which Kant ruled out. Okay. Now these are the three quartiles. There's median. The blue line is the first quartile, which is 25% of the countries are below the blue line, 25% of the countries are between blue line and red line, 25% are between red and green, and 25% are above. So this gives you a very good picture of what has been happening in the real world in terms of overall, and we haven't done any data analysis, as we haven't introduced any assumptions about IID errors or normality or anything. We're just plotting the data, and this is the information. Okay, this is one more set of lines. It's the same three lines, but we also have the minimum and the maximum. So if you look at the minimum, you see that even in 1960, there were countries which had 20 infant mortality, which is very, very low, and they have stayed. And even those countries have improved. They have gotten down to zero. So there's a lot of information here. Now here is a picture of Bahrain. And Bahrain started out in the third quartile. So it was very bad. It was worse than 75%. But over the period of time, it has converged to the first quartile. So it started out in the 75th percentile. It was very bad, and it has. So this is an important, we should go and look at what Bahrain did to achieve this performance. Now, this is Pakistan and Bangladesh and India. So there are the three quartiles which we can see. The red is the Q, the blue is the median. The green line, that's very important. The green line is the third quartile. So we are at 75%. Now if you look at the purple line for Pakistan, that is going down. So if you look at that, you can say that it was 180 in 1960, and it has become only 60. It's about one third. So we have made tremendous progress. But if you look at what has happened, we have maintained our position. So we have done neither well nor badly. We have just followed the general improvements globally. As opposed to this, if you look at the blue line, which is Bangladesh, they have overtaken us. They were started out at a worse position, and they ended up at a better position. So we should look at what has been happening in terms of this particular factor in Bangladesh. How did they do this? India has been consistently better than us, the orange line, but only by a slight amount, and they have performed the same as we have in terms of capturing the general global trend, but they haven't done any worse or any better. And this is the final chart, after which I will conclude. This, Iran started out much worse than us in 1960, but then it has now gone to median. So they have done something. What have they done? Egypt also has a similar chart. Egypt started out worse than Pakistan and has ended up much better than Pakistan. So now we should go to look at the reality. What were the programs that Iran undertook? What were the programs regarding infant mortality that were undertaken in Egypt which caused this? So basically, data analysis cannot be done in isolation with numbers only. You must go to the hidden reality in order to make sense and get sensible conclusion. I will conclude here.